Dr. Milton is Professor of Environmental Health at the University of Maryland School of Public Health, with a joint appointment in the medical school, where he is a leading researcher whose work focuses on the interrelated areas of infectious bioaerosols, exhaled breath analysis, and the development and application of innovative methods for respiratory epidemiology. We just want to dive in really quickly with a question about, what does medical science tell us about the aerosolization of viruses, particularly ones like COVID-19, and how the virus is spread, and how that might relate to decisions we might make as a singing community?
We're starting off talking about transmission perspective and how this is going to impact the future. So this virus now has only been around for 5 months now, I guess. And we're still learning a lot about it. As you know, it originated in Wuhan and appears to have moved from an animal reservoir into humans, and then began spreading rapidly in the human population because nobody has been exposed to it before. We don't have any immunity, and hence we are all susceptible. Early on, it became clear that there was some amount of asymptomatic transmission. The initial case was where this was reported was in the New England Journal. It appeared that someone was asymptomatic, came to a business meeting in Germany and infected two other people. It later turned out that she had had some symptoms while she was there, but even though she was symptomatic when she infected others, patient one in Germany wasn't symptomatic for several days. And yet during the time he was asymptomatic, he infected two other people. You may have seen an article in Science arguing that, well, this first person from Shanghai was not asymptomatic, but patient one in Germany was clearly asymptomatic when he infected patients three and four. And since then, we've seen a lot of evidence that asymptomatic persons are contagious. And in fact, a recent paper has suggested that perhaps the peak of contagiousness occurs just before the symptom onset. This is very different than what we had in SARS back in 2003, where people were very, very contagious late in the course of their illness, and early on seldom transmitted to anybody before they had symptoms. That made it much easier thing to control than what we're dealing with today. So how do we transmit respiratory infections? So the thinking is that there are really several different ways that we can do it. One is through large ballistic droplets, and you can get a direct hit, and you might be able to inhale them into your upper respiratory tract. If it's a coarse aerosol, you can breathe it in. And if it's a fine aerosol, it can float around on the airstreams, and you can inhale it. And some people would argue that the coarse aerosol is not airborne, but it's still floating in the air, and you're still sucking it in with your breath, as you are also doing with the fine aerosol. Ballistic droplets are not going to travel more than a few feet usually, but there's been recent work showing that if you have a powerful sneeze, you can have a plume that can travel many feet. So there's really two ways of talking about droplets and particles that can carry respiratory viruses. One is our standard medical categories, which we talk about, and you'll hear frequently people talking about respiratory droplets. The medical categories talk often about respiratory droplets, which seem is defined as vaguely as droplets that don't travel very far. And the mode of inoculation by respiratory droplets is unclear, but generally thought maybe to not be inhaled, probably more contamination of surfaces and then self-inoculation. So if you get it on your face and you rub your face and put it in your eyes or nose, and not considered airborne transmission, and then aerosols or droplet nuclei, which are generally thought to be less than 5 microns in diameter and small enough to travel long distances, and considered the only cause of airborne infection, and usually thought of as being that you have to see it happen at long distances or it's not happening. Whereas the basis in exposure science and pulmonary physiology, we talk about aerosols as being a wide range of particle sizes up to 50 to 100 microns in diameter, which some of which don't travel very far, others which can travel farther. And it turns out that inhaling through the nose and especially through the mouth, you can inhale droplets that are much larger than 5 microns. You can inhale droplets up to 100 microns. Think about pollen. Pollen tends to be quite large and can be inhaled and you get it stuck in the nose. And so the particles that are larger than about 20 microns mostly end up in the nose. Particles that are a bit smaller, less than 15 or 20 microns, end up deeper and they get into the trachea and large airways, but don't go out beyond that. And then particles less than 10 microns and especially less than 5 microns can penetrate much more deeply into the lung. And so we talk about these as inhalable fraction, the thoracic fraction or tracheal bronchial fraction, and the respirable fraction, the respirable fraction being the very small stuff that can get way out deep into the airways. But when we think about the size of the virus is so small that even a 1 micron particle could hold 1,000 coronavirus particles. So you don't need a very large particle to hold a lot of virus payload. And even when you're talking about particles in the 5 micron size range, where they begin to penetrate significantly into the lower airways, most of them still end up in your nose if you're nose breathing. So it's much more a continuum from very large things that don't get past your nostrils or your mouth, if you're mouth breathing, the things that can deposit far out in the lung. And it may make a difference as to how ill you become, where it deposited, and how much dose you got. And it's very likely that with SARS-CoV-2, that you need a pretty large dose to have a real risk of infection and symptoms. I then have a slide from a study by ACDA et al. Looking at aerosol emissions and super emissions during human speech with voice loudness. And it shows that the louder one speaks, the more aerosol one generates. This study did not really distinguish where the aerosol was coming from, what was coming from the lower respiratory tract and what was coming from the upper respiratory tract, which may be important depending on how much in the viruses in each of these locations at the time that the aerosol is being emitted. But it's quite clear that speech and by extension singing can be a big source of aerosols, but there's not as much study has been done of aerosols. And I recently got some emails from a colleague at the University of Colorado who's working with some colleagues at University of Maryland and others to look at aerosol generation from wind instruments as well. One of the things that has been a big interest in pulmonary physiology and pulmonary medicine for a long time is these aerosols coming from the deep lung, can we use them as a diagnostic? And so we've put some effort for the last 20 years into understanding how these aerosols are generated. Ironically, they were first noticed, in fact, at Los Alamos when they were doing respirator fit testing for nuclear workers, and they found that there were some workers that if they tested them even in a clean room where there was no particles in the air around them, and they they had them wear a full face respirator and they sampled inside the respirator, there were some people who always had particles inside their respirator. And they eventually figured out that these particles were coming from them. And it turns out that everybody generates some particles during breathing, even during quiet tidal breathing. But some people generate many times more than everybody else does. And it's a typical log normal distribution where you have 20% of the people account for 80% of all the particles that people generate. And it turns out that what's going on is that as you exhale, especially if you exhale all the way down to residual volume and really get all of the air out of your lungs, you collapse some small airways. And when you take a deep breath, you pop those airways open and there's a little fluid film that forms and breaks. And that film leaves a little droplet that you inhale into your alveolus. And on the next breath, you exhale it. And so I've taken even young, healthy people who don't shed many particles during tidal breathing because they don't collapse airways during tidal breathing, and had them exhale to residual volume and then up to TLC. And on the next breath, they'll put out 10,000 times as many particles as they do normally. And there's some tendency as we get older to because we lose elasticity, so we tend to have more airway closure at higher lung volumes and we generate more particles. So there's particle generation during normal tidal breathing, and this is highly variable. So some people do a lot of it, other people don't do very much. And there may be in some infections more of this happening during the infection than normally because you now have more fluid in the airways and they close more easily. So we have this elusive pathway, the aerobiological pathway of transmission of communicable respiratory disease, which is the title of an article that Chad Roy and I wrote in the New England Journal in 2004 to accompany an article about the Amoy Gardens outbreak of SARS, where 187 people were infected in one event when somebody who was immunosuppressed went to visit his nephew. He was suffering from SARS, but didn't realize what he had, used the toilet and flushed it up on something like the 20th floor. And the soil stack, the feces fell 20 stories, creating an aerosol in the soil stack. Many people were not watering the floor drains in the bathroom, and the bathrooms all had exhaust fans that put them under negative pressure to the soil stack. And it pulled this fecal aerosol up into the homes and spread it through the apartment complex. And it traveled between buildings, but only to certain other buildings that were downwind of that. And the buildings that were not downwind didn't get infected at all. And a computational fluid dynamic multi-zone model of the air movement in these buildings modeled exactly where all the cases were. So we know this event, which was a very unusual circumstance, hopefully, but the particle sizes of the droplets that are generated depend on how they were generated. Are they generated from a sewage aerosol like that? Or are they generated by moving objects that have, like flapping a blanket that has stuff on it? Or is it generated from the respiratory tract? And if they're generated like the airway closure and reopening, they're very small. They're only big enough to hold very few viral particles, whereas if they are generated in the upper respiratory tract, they tend to be larger and they're in the single to micron and up range. They can be increased by coughing and singing and talking and so forth. Then when they're in the air, their liquid droplets, their dynamic sizes, they dry out. They may be exposed to sunlight. And as they dry out and they concentrate, that may damage the virus so that it can't reproduce after it lands. Ultraviolet light might cause decay of the virus. There's been a controversy lately about whether sunlight kills the virus. And I can tell you it does. There's a preprint from the National Biodefense and Countermeasures Center that shows that it does. And then when you inhale it, what happens to it? Where does it land? Well, it depends on what size it got to and how fast it rehydrates in your airways and where it's going to land and what's going to happen to it then. So I've been doing studies now for 15 years looking at exhaled breath of infected cases. We developed a device we call the Gesundheit 2 back in 2006-07 that was designed to be able to test this question of, if you put surgical masks on people who are sick, will it reduce how much virus they shed into the air? And indeed, we found that it does do something, but we also looked at how much virus people were shedding into the air when they didn't wear a mask and how much did coughing contribute. And what we found was is that people who just sat in the device for half an hour and didn't cough the entire time they were in there and recited the alphabet three times still could be detected to have shed infectious influenza virus that we could culture from their breath, and it was in fine particles less than 5 microns in diameter. So that really answered this question. It wasn't just that there's like a signature from the nucleic acid present. There's real infectious virus in these particles. And as people coughed, people who were coughing were shedding more virus, but coughing wasn't necessary for shedding virus. And then I have a slide showing the computational fluid dynamic model of the Amway Gardens that was published in the New England Journal, and also a paper from Clinical Infectious Diseases published in 2016 of investigators who were air sampling in the hallway outside of a MERS patient room in South Korea and were able to culture the virus from the air outside of a room that was under negative pressure. So clearly people walking in and out the door were dragging aerosol out of the room, and they were able to culture the air in the virus from the air in the hallway. And recently, there are some papers. There's a paper in Nature last week showing that the nucleic acid signature of the virus, although they didn't culture it in that paper, was present in the air in even very small particle sizes, down much less than 1 micron, in the air in hospitals in Wuhan. So we know it can get into the air. We're not entirely sure how it gets there, but some of it's probably directly from the respiratory tract. And then the question is, well, how long does it survive? And there was a paper in the New England Journal showing that aerosolized by using a Collison nebulizer, which is a real brutal way to generate an aerosol. And it's kind of surprising the virus survives it, but it does. And most influenza viruses survive it too, but not all of them. But once it got into the air, it persisted in the air, even though they were using a temperature and relative humidity conditions that are actually pretty unfavorable for the virus. So we would expect, in fact, that if they had used lower relative humidities or higher relative humidities, that it probably would have survived even better. And then there's a preprint from a group in Singapore that I've been consulting with using size selective samplers in a high containment unit in Singapore. And they too have been able to show that the virus was present in 1 to 4 micron and larger than 4 micron aerosols in a room that was having 12 air changes per hour of ventilation with directed flow from the ceiling across the bed and then out by the head of the bed, and still were able to pick it up in the room. So again, that's not very comforting. And then there's a paper from the University of Nebraska that's out in a preprint where they were able to pick it up in the hallway. Although it turns out the sampler in the hallway was placed on the floor. So I'm not sure how worried I am about that. Although the fact that they're picking it up in the hallway in the Nebraska containment unit, that's where we were treating Ebola cases, okay? It's a high containment unit, and that's a bit worrisome. And even more worrisome is that the personal sampler that the person was wearing who was going in the room and setting up the samplers had a lot more virus on it than the area samplers did. So it clearly personnel are at risk. And now, that said, in Nebraska, they have very good practices with personal protective equipment and respirators and the whole bit, and nobody working there has been infected. You have probably heard a lot about the restaurant outbreak that was published in the Emerging Infectious Diseases now a couple weeks ago. I was interviewed for ABC The World Tonight on Friday, and they had a segment, and they had this picture that I have here from Hugo Lee's paper, which is another paper about the same outbreak that has done a detailed engineering outbreak, including releasing tracer grasses and reproducing the conditions to really understand what was happening in the restaurant. And what it turns out is that there was no dilution ventilation in this restaurant. They had sealed up the exhaust vents. And so they had mini splits up on the ceiling that were just recirculating the air. And the way it was set up, the back end of the restaurant away from the elevator and the entrance on this third floor dining room was basically a dead zone. And they were just recirculating the air around the back end of the room. And so people at the other side of the room had much lower exposures. So there's been a lot of debate about the authors of the EID paper said, well, this shows that it's large droplets. But as the host on the night on the ABC News said, you know, some of the people were 15 feet away. Okay. So, you know, this is not like, so the authors are saying, well, it's large droplets and it's not aerosols. But a definition of an aerosol is a particle or a droplet that's following the air currents. Well, that's an aerosol by definition. Now, it's true that us aerobiologists over a couple of beers like to argue about whether a cow in a tornado is a bioaerosol. But the point is that these are droplets that are still probably small enough that you can inhale them. So it could be that they settled out on people's dishes and they ate them, but it seems more likely to me that they inhaled them. But it may be that they were in the, you know, 20 micron and up particle size, and that's why they didn't get that far down into the other part of the restaurant. But it also may be a dose issue. It's not clear to me that anybody went in and tested everybody else in the restaurant, and we know that people who got lower exposures weren't asymptomatic infected.